This is your 20-minute podcast, where we do our best to give you useful information in 20 minutes or less. Today's podcast is brought to you by Audible. Get a free audiobook download and 30-day free trial at audibletrial.com/your20-minute podcast. Over 180,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. Now, here's your host, David Brower.
Hi, this is David Brower, and your 20-minute podcast continues with our special guest today, Todd Laments. Did I pronounce that right?
Perfect pronunciation, David.
All right. Score one for me. Todd is a business and motivational speaker with a specialization in personal accountability and business accountability. He's also an expert in ego control and keeping things in proper perspective. Todd's received national speaker awards and spoke to more than 500 huge corporations, been sharing his perspective since 2008, and has designed sales programs for more than 50 direct sales organizations. He's authored three books, Think Thin, Feel Amazing, Leverage Your Life, and your latest one, Lose Your Ego, Gain the World. Boy, if that doesn't get your attention, I don't know what does.
Oh, yeah. Thanks, David. Yeah, my latest book is about some of the struggles I had in business. I'm not coming up, but once I got successful and how my ego destroyed every part of my life, my physical life, my financial life, and all my relationships.
I tell you what, and I don't know that it's primarily a male thing. You probably undoubtedly know better than I, but it sure seems like testosterone and ego cause a lot of problems when they're in high force.
I don't think it is mostly a male thing, but I can say this. I learned from my sales career that one of the big rapport things is when you talk to women, you talk about their kids.
Yeah.
And when you talk to men, you talk about their jobs. So a lot of times the two will find their significance, and that's not always right, but about 99% of the time it's right. So men like to pound on their chests, and we find a lot of our self-worth in what we do and how much money we make.
Yeah, true story. So I'm intrigued by the accountability piece because that encounters everything, whether it's business or relationships or kids or dogs or whatever. And How do you train that, or how do you share that with people?
You want to be held accountable, and the reason, in your personal life and your business life is because you want to have control of it. Like as humans, we like to have control, and I think it really starts with honesty. The people who seem to be the most honest seem to be the most successful. And so if you can really be humble and be grateful for what you have and what you're good at, you'll go a long ways.
Gratitude's a big part of life now, isn't it?
It is. We forget. A lot of times, I get to talk to a lot of very successful people, and I've found that people who are really successful are not good self-evaluators because they've taken so much action.
Yeah.
They don't really know what worked. And so anytime they start talking about, and what they do always do is talk about how tough they have it. And every time they start down that road, I always stop them and say, well, that's true. But I also want to hear about the blessings and the breaks that you've had and the people that have helped you, because that is as much of the story as all the tough times.
I don't know. I'm a big fan of paying it forward, counting my blessings, and sharing gratitude where it belongs. And I think you're able to lift people up that way, not only personally, but business-wise.
Absolutely.
So what's the biggest struggle you found in sharing accountability with people or businesses? Have you found people just kind of hitting their head against the wall and I have no idea what you're talking about?
Usually what it is, I have a lot of people at work that need that, and what I try to say is I look at it like a grade school education. Dave, you might be in Harvard in one subject and I might be in the third grade.
Right.
One of the problems I've had in business is just my emotional, I'm an emotional person and I can't seem to keep that at home. I seem to bring that to work. And unfortunately I bring work to home too. So that's just something I struggle with. And other people don't have that problem. They go to work and they go home and they're at home. And I envy those people. So I think that if you're good at something, you should be great at it. If you're already inclined at it, if you got that in you. And I think that's the way people look at it. Not like, oh, I'm good in that area.
Right.
Professional athletes don't say, oh, I'm great. I don't need to practice anymore. Or they wouldn't be professionals anymore.
Right. So I think entrepreneurship is, people go into that, start their own businesses. Maybe they work by themselves or have one or two partners that they work with. And sometimes I would think accountability in that area is absolutely critical to help grow your business.
It is. You got to surround yourself with the right people. I think when you're starting out, What I've found and why most people stop starting a business or will keep from them from getting started is fear, or they think they don't have enough resources. And I think you're actually, my experience has been, I've started up several small businesses, some successful, some not. And what I've noticed is when I have more resources, I waste more.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah. And I don't do things myself. I'm more often to pay it, write a check to somebody and hope that they take care of it. Well, I think in your small business, and especially if it's your small business, you have a passion for it, you need to have some competency in everything you do. So you don't have to be an expert at it, but you at least need to know enough to hold the people you partner with accountable for what they do.
I remember a few years, well, it's probably been 15 years ago, and I was in Northern California managing a group of radio stations. And anytime one of my friends would call me up and say, well, do you know how to do this? And I said, no, but I got a guy.
Yeah, exactly.
You know, and now that I'm out of that and out of the corporate thing and running my own business, it's like such a gift to be able to tap into different people, learn from them, mentor them, do all those things and not have the worries of being an employee. I think that's a real struggle for a lot of folks.
It is. It's a different mindset. You have to throw out, you know, a lot of times when I'm not being my most productive self, you'll hear me reading my resume to you. And what I'm doing is I'm insecure because you don't care what I used to do. You care what I did today and what I could do for you.
Right.
So a lot of times we get caught up in, well, I made this much an hour, or I was the vice president of this. And those things are true, but now you're a newer, better person. You know, you learn from your, well, I only learn when I lose, and I'm more human than most. So I've made more mistakes. And that's what we got me here. And that's why I'm of value to you today.
So how did you get into this? How did you get it? What was the epiphany that said, I got to help people with accountability. I got to help them control their ego and take proper perspectives and stuff. Was it just your own life's lesson that you wanted to share with folks?
I did. Well, I started several small businesses. I've been a serial entrepreneur my whole life, and they all failed in my early 20s. But in my late 20s and early 30s, I had a business that it was my ex-wife and I, and we took it from just her and I to 80 employees, and
wow,
we had a lot of success. And what the ruin of that company was all done through me taking people for granted, overspending, overpartying, and I really had a sense of entitlement. I thought that at the time, David, I really thought that I was smarter than everybody else, and I worked harder than everybody else, and this was my reward.
Yeah. Well, that's where your ego gets in the way, right?
Yeah, absolutely. So after that experience and being behind on payroll and going bankrupt and losing multiple houses, I mean, it goes on and on. I just wanted to share my story so other people didn't, you know, repeat the same mistake I made.
Good for you. Good for you. I've been in many of those places you just rattled off. I've been there, done that. And so I totally understand what you're talking about. Your latest book, Lose Your Ego and Gain the World. So somebody picks that up. Is it a hard copy? Is it available through Amazon? Is it an audiobook? How do people get that?
It's exclusively on Amazon.
Okay.
And it's got lots of reviews. So
let's kind of cut to what that book's about and why people should go invest in that, spend some time with it. What's it going to do for them one-on-one? I'm sitting here in my chair and I want to read your book. What's going to be the payoff for me?
It's going to motivate you to take action. It's going to let you know that you're okay right now and that you are where you are right now for a reason, and that you don't need to read any more books. You don't have to go to any more seminars. The most important thing is to get started right now. And when I start up a business, I like to get started and start making mistakes. And what most people think is that people who are more successful than them know more than they do or are smarter than they do. And that's not true. The only thing different between you and them is that they took action and they've made more mistakes than you. That's how they got there. They failed more.
Right.
And everyone knows this from their work experience. Have you ever worked with somebody or for somebody and you say, you know what? I'm more talented than this person. I'm smarter than this person. Why is this person my boss?
Right. Oh my gosh. Hasn't everybody been there?
Yeah,
that's a true story. And then when you become the boss, you know that people are saying that about you.
It's true. I always, in my seminars, I talk about when your boss asks you a question, they don't want the answer. They already know the answer. They just want to know what your thinking was or your messed up thinking was.
Right, right, right. Yeah.
So always tell them the truth because, you know, they've got their 10,000 hours in this subject.
Right.
And so they've already seen this movie or read this book 5 or 6 times. So just tell them the truth. It's the best approach.
Well, yeah. And the other side of that is people have a tendency to tell their bosses what they think they want to hear rather than just being straight with them.
Yeah. Honesty goes a long way.
No question about it.
It'll serve you well in your professional career. And in a small business, it's absolutely It's absolutely imperative. You know, my ex-wife used to say, you see a lot of, you know, I'm a religious person. And my ex-wife used to say, you know, a lot of times in businesses, people will put fish up or brag about being Christians in their ads. And she said, don't tell them you're a Christian. Just show them you are. And that always stuck with me. And I always appreciated that.
Could not agree more. I'm very much the same. And I think when you have the opportunity to model for other people, whether it's personal or religious or business environment or whatever, anytime you can be genuine and authentic and model what you want them to absorb, that's a gift, right?
Absolutely. And when you're starting your own business, make sure that you tell everybody what you do and tell them over and over again. You know, as humans, I think we seem to think that we're the center of the universe, right?
Right.
David and Todd are the center of the universe.
Right.
And so we just assume because we put a post on Facebook once that everybody knows we have our own business. And then you'll find out 6 months later, they didn't even remember that you were doing that.
Right, right.
There's a reason Coke and Pepsi puts Super Bowl ads on that cost $5 million. Everyone knows what Coke and Pepsi is, but they still have to keep reminding us. And if Coke and Pepsi has to do that, then, you know, David and Todd do also.
No question about it. I mean, the amount of clutter that we have to compete with in any kind of marketing, whether it's radio, TV, social, I mean, you got to figure out a way to cut through the clutter so people have a chance to recognize who you are and what you do.
Absolutely. And get a healthy obsession for your business. You need to remember when you're starting up that you're competing with people who have already been obsessed with this business before you.
Right.
So they've already got some momentum and they've already made those mistakes. So you're going to have to put more time in than they are. A lot of times people, we start home-based businesses and we think we just put a web page up and people are going to flood to our business.
True story.
It's like getting married or having a baby.
Right.
That's when all the work starts.
Right. That's only the beginning, man. You got to step up.
Absolutely.
So when you're talking to people about starting businesses, and obviously you've done tons of businesses yourself. And I think that's, I mean, honestly, I believe that's so important for you to fail. You can't learn and grow unless you recognize your mistakes and learn from those. So when people are starting a new business and they're visiting with you, what do you encourage them to do from a personnel standpoint, a marketing standpoint? How do you kind of motivate them to go in the right direction?
First and foremost, that's a great question. Get people who are not like you. You know, as humans, I always like people who are like me. And what I realized in business, I like to do the analogy. I love football.
Yeah.
So on a football team, you need a kicker, a quarterback, a receiver. You have people with different body types, different skills, different speeds, different strengths. And what usually people do when they start their own business, they just try to find their friends who are exactly like them. And you're going to need somebody. First of all, you need to surround yourself with people who are honest with you,
right?
Who will hurt your feelings, and find people who are good at things that you're not good at, and use them and appreciate them, and always have confidence in all your people, you know, and don't give up on them. So the second you've given up as a boss,
yeah,
they're going to give up on themselves.
Well,
it's impossible to succeed unless someone believes in you.
Absolutely right. And I mean, when you look at businesses today and the turnover and the lack of loyalty and all that kind of stuff, if you don't model loyalty, if you don't model appreciation and gratitude, how do you expect to hang on to good people, you know?
That's absolutely right. You have to, and you have to take massive action and just learn in your own business. Become a real student of it. You know, I always think it's funny, as you know, first and foremost, the number one parenting book was written by Oprah,
who right?
never had a kid. But I always think it's funny. I think if you have a passion as a younger person, I love baseball. So I used to go into the library and read every book I could about baseball. If you really love something, you have to really put your time in it and get your 10,000 hours.
Yeah.
And it's going to save you money and it's going to make you even more money.
So how many businesses are you working right now? Just you?
Just my speaking business and promoting my book.
Yeah.
You know, I thought if I wrote a book, that millions of dollars would come floating in the mail and I would be happy. I would be on these Manhattan book signings. And
right.
No. It's a lot more work than it looks.
The analogy that you just had of having a baby, it's just like that. You've got your book and now you got to go out and make this puppy grow, you know?
That's right. Water your flowers. Water your flowers, not your weeds.
Yeah, well said. So how many speaking engagements do you do a week, a month, a year? I mean, are you out there a lot?
50 to 60 a year.
That's a lot.
Yeah, but I want to do twice that this year. And to do that, I'm working on getting some new material. I write new content every day. I write 500 words of content every day. And most of it isn't that good. But I keep, you know, I kind of look at it like physical training. You got to get those reps in.
Well, I think that's right. And when you write that 500 words of content, what do you do with it?
I make YouTube videos. I put it on blogs. I share it with other people who need material. And then sometimes I put in speeches if the stuff, or replace some other stuff. So I upgrade and change some stuff. A lot of times my speeches get revised by going and meeting with companies, and then somebody will make a comment to me and I think, oh, that's good. I'm going to steal that. I'm going to write that down.
Yeah. I call that creative optimization. You know, you're just kind of borrowing it and using it in a good way, you know, and then when you get success out of that one liner, you can go back and say, dude, thank you so much. And he'll go, what are you talking about? You know,
great.
That's awesome. So how do you double your speaking engagements? How does that grow for you?
Referrals is a big one.
Yeah.
But the big one is doing stuff like this, promotional. I do two radio shows a day.
Nice.
And I enjoy it. It's a lot of fun. I mean, this is the fun part of it.
Right. Yeah.
You know, I feel very comfortable, but I didn't always, you know, it took me time. I still get a little nervous and I like that because it means I care.
Exactly right. Yeah. Butterflies are a wonderful thing.
Yeah. When you stop caring, it's time to do something else.
Yep. So people want to learn more about you and what you can do for personal accountability, business accountability, helping them learn about ego control and keeping things in proper perspective. They can get your book online, right, at Amazon, and then reach out to you through your website, or how do they learn more about you?
Any of your listeners, they want my book, they can just contact me on Twitter. I have over 200,000 followers on Twitter, and I'd be happy to just send you a copy. So.
Okay. Cool. So twitter.com/Todd Laments.
Just put me in there and you'll see me.
Nice. 200,000. Holy crap.
From doing all these great radio shows like yours.
Flatter will get you everywhere, man. That's awesome. That's awesome. Hey, Todd, it's really been a treat to talk to you. And thank you for going through all the struggles to be able to pay it forward and help other people learn from your good stuff and your troubles.
Thank you, David. And have me back on your show sometimes. A lot of fun.
I will. Absolutely right. You've been listening to Your 20-Minute Podcast with David Brower and Todd Laments. Be sure to like us on Facebook at facebook.com/Your 20-Minute Podcast.
Until next time, don't forget to download your free audiobook at audibletrial.com/Your 20-Minute Podcast. That's audibletrial.com/Your 20-Minute Podcast for your free audiobook. And thanks for listening to Your 20-Minute Podcast with David Brower. Power.